The Statutes of Revolutionary Trade Unionism, IWA, last update January 2020, introduction. The history of humanity is shaped by the struggle between exploiters and exploited, which is currently manifested in the attacks of capitalism and the state against the working class in all areas of life. Capitalists, managers and politicians are organizing to promote their interests as much as possible. If we want to confront them, promote our own interests and build the society we want, we have to overcome the weakness and disorganization of the labor movement. To achieve this, it is necessary to organize ourselves in a structure of struggle that unites all revolutionary workers around the world. The actions of such an organization must demonstrate that it is capable of surpassing capitalism and the state. A movement for emancipation thus constructed cannot accept the line of action promoted by those currents of the labor movement that aspire to harmony between capital and labor, desiring an international peace with capitalism and incorporation into the state. Nor can it accept those currents that propagate the existence of the state or the dictatorship of the proletariat, which is contrary to our goal of a society based on the greatest possible freedom and well-being for all. Against the offensive of capital and politicians of all shades, all the revolutionary workers of the world must build a true international workers' association, in which each member will know that the emancipation of the working class will only be possible when the workers themselves, in as producers, they manage to prepare themselves in their political-economic organizations to take possession of the land and factories and to train themselves to manage them jointly, in such a way that they can continue production and social life. Taking into account this perspective and goal, the duty of workers is to participate in all actions that lead to a revolutionary transformation of society, always striving to advance towards our final goals. We must make our strength felt through this participation, always striving to give our movement, through organization, action and propaganda, the necessary means to supplant our adversaries. In the same way, whenever possible, we must make our social system through models and examples, and our organizations must exercise, to the limit of their possibilities, the greatest possible influence on other trends so that they can join our struggle, which it is the common struggle against all statist and capitalist adversaries, always taking into account the circumstances of the place and time. 2. The principles of revolutionary unionism. 1. Revolutionary unionism, supported by the class struggle, seeks to unite all workers in combative economic organizations that struggle to free themselves from the double yoke of capital and the state. Its objective is the reorganization of social life on the basis of libertarian communism through the revolutionary action of the working class. Since only the economic organizations of the proletariat are capable of achieving this goal, revolutionary syndicalism targets the workers in their capacity as producers, creators of social wealth, to root and develop among themselves, in opposition to the modern workers' parties, which declares they are incapable of the economic reorganization of society. 2. Revolutionary unionism is the staunch enemy of all social and economic monopoly and aims at its abolition through the establishment of economic communities and administrative bodies run by workers in the fields and factories, forming a system of free councils without subordination to any authority or political party, without exception. As an alternative to state and party politics, revolutionary unionism proposes the economic reorganization of production, substituting the domination of man over man for the administrative management of things. Consequently, the aim of revolutionary syndicalism is not the conquest of political power, but the abolition of all state functions in the life of society. Revolutionary syndicalism considers that together with the disappearance of the monopoly of property, must come the disappearance of the monopoly of domination. 3. Revolutionary trade unionism has a double function: to carry out the daily revolutionary struggle for the economic, social and intellectual advancement of the working class within the limits of today's society, and to educate the masses so that they will be prepared to manage as independently form the processes of production and distribution when the time comes to take possession of all the elements of social life. Revolutionary unionism does not accept the idea that the organization of a social system based exclusively on the producing class can be ordered by simple government decrees, and maintains that it can only be achieved through the common action of all manual and intellectual workers, in all branches. From the country, industry, through the self-management of workers, so that each group, 4. Revolutionary unionism opposes all organizational trends inspired by the centralism of the state and the church, because these can only serve to prolong the survival of the state and authority and systematically stifle the spirit of initiative and independence of thought. Centralism is an artificial organization that subjects the so-called lower classes to those who claim to be superior, and that leaves the affairs of the entire community in the hands of a few, turning the individual into the robot with controlled gestures and movements. In centralized organization, the good of society is subordinated to the interests of a few, variety is replaced by uniformity, and personal responsibility is replaced by rigid discipline. Consequently, revolutionary syndicalism bases its social vision on a broad federalist organization, that is to say, 5. Revolutionary unionism rejects all parliamentary activity and all collaboration with legislative bodies, because it knows that even the freest voting system cannot bring about the disappearance of the clear contradictions in the core of today's society, and because the parliamentary system has only one goal, to give a claim to legitimacy to the realm of falsehood and social injustice. 6. Revolutionary trade unionism rejects all political and national borders, which are created arbitrarily, and declares that so-called nationalism is only the modern state religion, behind which the material interests of the property classes are hidden. Revolutionary unionism recognizes only economic, regional or national differences, which produce hierarchies, privileges and all kinds of oppressions, for reasons of race, sex and any false or real difference, and in a spirit of solidarity it claims the right to self-determination of all economic groups. 7. For the same reason, revolutionary trade unionism fights against militarism and war. Revolutionary unionism advocates propaganda against the war and the replacement of the standing armies, which are only the instruments of the counter-revolution at the service of capitalism, by workers' militias, which during the revolution will be controlled by the workers' unions. It also demands the boycott and embargo of all raw materials and products necessary for war, with the exception of a country where the workers are in the midst of social revolution, in which case we must help them defend the revolution. Finally, revolutionary unionism defends the preventive and revolutionary general strike as a means of opposition to war and militarism. 8. Revolutionary unionism recognizes the need for production that does not harm the environment, that tries to minimize the use of non-renewable resources and uses, whenever possible, renewable alternatives. It does not admit ignorance as the origin of the current environmental crisis, but the thirst for profit. Capitalist production always seeks to minimize costs in order to obtain more profit to survive, and it is unable to protect the environment. In short, the global debt crisis has accelerated the trend towards commercial harvesting to the detriment of subsistence farming. This fact has produced the destruction of the tropical forest, hunger and disease. The fight to save our planet and the fight to destroy capitalism must be joint, or both will fail. 9. Revolutionary unionism asserts itself as a supporter of the method of direct action, and helps and encourages all struggles that do not contradict its own aims. Their fighting methods are strikes, boycotts, sabotage, etc. Direct action reaches its deepest expression in the general strike, which must also be, from the point of view of revolutionary syndicalism, the prelude to social revolution. 10. While revolutionary unionism opposes all organized violence regardless of the type of government, it realizes that there will be extremely violent clashes during the decisive struggles between today's capitalism and tomorrow's free communism. Consequently, it recognizes as valid that violence can be used as a means of defense against the violent methods used by the ruling classes during the struggles that lead to the expropriation of land and means of production by the revolutionary people. Since this expropriation can only be carried out and brought to fruition through the direct intervention of the revolutionary economic workers' organizations, the defense of the revolution must also be the task of these economic organizations and not of a developing military or quasi-military body, regardless of them. 11. Only in the economic and revolutionary organizations of the working class are the forces capable of achieving their liberation and the creative energy necessary for the reorganization of society on the basis of libertarian communism. 3. Name of the international organization. The international bond of struggle and solidarity that unites the revolutionary trade union organizations of the world is called the International Workers' Association, IWA. 4. Goals and objectives of the IWA. The IWA has the following objectives: organize and press for the revolutionary struggle in all countries with the aim of destroying once and for all the current political and economic regimes and establishing libertarian communism. Provide trade union economic organizations with a national and industrial base and, where it already exists, strengthen those organizations that are determined to fight for the destruction of capitalism and the state. Prevent the infiltration of any political party into trade union economic organizations and resolutely fight any attempt by political parties to control trade unions. When circumstances require it, establish through a course of action that does not contradict A, B, and C, provisional alliances with other proletarian, trade union and revolutionary organizations, with the objective of planning and carrying out common international actions in the interest of the working class. Such alliances should never be with political parties, that is, with organizations that accept the state as a system of social organization. Revolutionary unionism rejects class collaboration that is characterized by participation in committees organized under state corporate schemes, for example, in union elections for works councils, and by the acceptance of subsidies, paid union professionals, and other practices that can spoil the anarcho-syndicalism. Unmask and combat the arbitrary violence of all governments against revolutionaries dedicated to the cause of the social revolution. Examine all the problems that concern the world proletariat in order to strengthen and develop movements, in one country or in several, that help to defend the rights and new conquests of the working class or to organize the revolution for emancipation itself. Undertake mutual aid actions in case of major economic struggles or critical struggles against open or covert enemies of the working class. Give moral and material help to the workers' movements in every country in which the leadership of the struggle is in the hands of the national economic organization of the proletariat. The international intervenes in the trade union affairs of a country only when its affiliated organization in that country requests it or when the affiliate violates the general principles of the international. V. Membership conditions. They can join the IWA, national revolutionary trade union organizations that do not belong to any other international. In all cases there will only be one section in each country. Affiliated sections must ratify the IWA principles, tactics and objectives and send a copy of its statutes and principles to the Secretariat. The IWA International Secretariat will inform the sections of the origin of the contact or contacts that have requested membership. Minorities of revolutionary trade unionists organized within other national organizations affiliated with other trade union internationals. Trade union, artisan, industrial or general organizations that are independent or affiliated with national organizations that do not belong to the IWA, that accept the declaration of principles and objectives of the IWA. Any revolutionary union propaganda organization that accepts is the IWA declaration of principles and goals and that works in a country where there is no national organization affiliated with the IWA. Since the IWA only consists of legal or illegal sections with direct connection within the respective countries, the only groups that can be recognized as IWA sections are those exiled groups that can give clear evidence to the IWA Secretariat that they are authentic representatives of organizations that act and work in the respective countries. In any case, there may only be one section for each country. The following types of behavior can lead to disenrollment or suspension: non-compliance with the principles, tactics and objectives of the IWA, failure to pay membership fees. If a section does not pay its dues for a year, Congress will have to consider disapproval of the sections. If a section does not attend meetings and congresses of the international, nor does it respond to contact requests from the IWA secretariat or sections, without explanation, membership and disaffiliation take place at the IWA Congress. A section may disenroll from the IWA in the period between congresses. Suspension can be agreed during a plenary or congress based on a previous motion, or by referendum if a plenary or congress so agrees. A section may be suspended for reasons of non-compliance with the statutes or action against the agreements of Congress or the interest of the IWA, to be agreed by motion and decision of the sections. Membership may be suspended due to division or confusion as to whether a section still remains, pending an investigation by a commission. If a section is not up to date, does not pay its dues for a year, but Congress decided not to disenroll it, the section can be suspended. Suspension means that the section does not have the right to vote in congresses, plenaries or referendums, nor the right to present motions. It maintains the same rights as the friends of the IWA to receive documents, attend all congresses and give opinions. If a section remains suspended for a period of time, Congress may decide to change its status to friends, upon such motion. So, the international congresses, the congresses IWA internationals are held every 3 years. The secretariat will request from the sections, well in advance of the congress, questions or suggestions for them to be dealt with by the congress. Next, the secretariat will prepare the order of the day, which together with the motions presented, will be sent to the affiliated organizations at least 6 months before the start of the congress. Each plenary or congress is registered and the minutes are prepared with the greatest possible fidelity. The minutes are subject to the approval of the sections. The agreements and resolutions adopted by the international congresses are binding for all affiliated organizations, except when said organizations, by resolution of a national congress or by referendum, reject the agreements of the international congress. At the request of at least 3 affiliated national organizations, an international agreement may be submitted for review by general referendum within all sections. In international referendums and congresses, each section has 1 vote and it is recommended to seek unanimity before proceeding to the vote. 7. International transfer. Any member of an IWA affiliated organization who has paid all their membership fees, but resides in a country other than the one in which they joined, must do so no later than 1 month after arrival. Transfer to the organization corresponding to the national organization affiliated to the IWA. This transfer must be approved by said national organization without a check-in contribution. In the case of a forced mass exile, membership is voluntary if there is membership in an exiled organization recognized by the IWA. 8. The secretary coordinate the international activities of the IWA, obtain and organize truthful information on the propaganda and the struggle in all countries, implement in the best way the resolutions of the international congresses and take care of all the work of the IWA, a secretariat composed of at least 3 people, from 1 or more sections. The section, S, that hold the secretariat is, or are, elected by Congress or by international referendum. Usually the secretariat is in charge of a section, but this task can be shared. The Secretary General, the Treasurer and the other members will be elected by those who hold the secretariat. The members of the secretariat will distribute the tasks and work among themselves. They can also delegate certain tasks to other sections. Members of political parties cannot hold positions of responsibility in the IWA. The secretariat is elected as indicated above for the period from 1 ordinary congress to the next. The same sections must only serve 2 consecutive terms. The section or sections that occupied the secretariat must rotate. The secretariat may return to a section that it previously occupied only after a period of rotation. In the event of extraordinary circumstances in which Congress does not elect a new secretariat, it must agree on the measures to be taken. The secretariat will not accept a salary or any personal payment for the fulfillment of its mandate. The Secretariat will provide regular financial reports to the IWA. She is responsible for the distribution of written communications to all sections and friends and for maintaining adequate records thereof. You must make a written report on your activities during the period between congresses and plenary sessions. The report must be presented sufficiently in advance for the affiliated sections to become familiar with it before the congress and plenary are held. At the same time, an administrative economic report will be presented and sent to the sections. The congress and the plenary will appoint a commission that during the congress and the plenary will carry out an inspection of the accounts. Vice Secretariat as Deputy Secretary is also elected by Congress or by referendum. The Vice Secretariat only has the mandate to serve as a replacement for the Secretariat, in the event that it becomes totally inoperative or is withdrawn by the sections. It is not mandated to represent the IWA or perform any other functions, unless they are tasks delegated by the Secretariat. Resilience: the Secretariat can be revoked in a referendum of the IWA sections. To start the referendum, at least three sections of the IWA must support a motion. Following the motion supported by three sections, a referendum must be announced immediately and sections have 90 days to vote. In the event that the Secretariat does not initiate the referendum process within a week since the third section supported the motion, the Vice Secretariat must do so. If the Secretariat is dismissed, the Vice Secretariat must assume its role until the next Congress is held. In special circumstances, the Vice Secretary must replace the Secretary. A. In cases of political repression, arrest, war or other acts of force majeure that make it impossible to carry out the charge. In these cases, the Secretariat is not considered withdrawn, but replaced. If possible and feasible, the Secretariat may later be transferred back to that section. B. If the Secretariat has not functioned for a period of time greater than 3 months, has not responded to correspondence, calls or producing bulletins, or if it has not properly convened the Congress or plenary, without reason or agreement, which causes it to be postponed for more than 3 months, the Vice Secretariat should assume the functions of Secretariat to ensure the proper functioning of the IWA. Once these duties are assumed, the Vice Secretariat must inform the sections and the make a motion to revoke the Secretariat through the referendum process described above. 9. Finance: allow the IWA to carry out and strengthen its international activities and give its written propaganda a solid foundation, allow you to publish your periodicals at regular intervals, allow it to participate in all manifestations of the life of revolutionary unionism in the different countries, to be able to promote the ideas of revolutionary unionism in countries where our ideas and tactics are poorly represented, and finally, in order for the IWA to respond satisfactorily and immediately to the calls for solidarity that it may receive, each member of an organization affiliated to the IWA will have to pay monthly, as an international membership fee, the amount of $1. $1, or its equivalent in national currency, taking into consideration the exchange value in the countries in question. For those sections that are in a difficult situation, the fees are set in accordance with the rest of the IWA. Each affiliated section will decide for itself the procedure to follow in order to receive the affiliation fee from its members. The IWA has a special stamp to seal the membership card for those sections that wish to do so. The affiliate section will send the stipulated membership fee to the IWA on a quarterly basis. X. Publications: the Secretariat publishes a post that should be published as often as possible. It is desirable that all that newspapers published by organizations affiliated with the IWA or sympathizers of it reserve a special space on their pages for information about the IWA, for calls for international solidarity and for general propaganda. Propaganda brochures, mainly aimed at places where our movement has no national affiliated organization. All other publications, periodical or not, that Congress decides.